Another new engine. This is the M17 or the EM3. Comes with spare O-rings for the piston. These same O-rings are used on the ET5, ET5 Pro, and the EM1, 2, 3, and 4. It's all the same one. This does not have a rope starter. And the starting adapter for the cordless is smaller than the other engines. The packaging fits in these boxes very snug, and they tend to be cut out and designed for each engine. It's very good packaging. This is another attractive little engine. It does not have a rope starter pulley on here, so there's no need for a pull cord. You can start it with your cordless drill, possibly by hand. These bases tend to get in the way when you're trying to hand start it. This engine right out of the box seems to have pretty good compression. The bearing caps are put on here at an angle. That's a little bit different. And we now have this little guard that goes over the crankshaft and the connecting rod. The magnet for the Hall effect sensor is in the back of this pulley. This pulley can be used for an O-ring or drive belt to some external device. The Hall effect sensor is here. The cam for the exhaust valve is behind this gear. This is, again, a 2-to-1 reduction, 4-cycle engine. Atmospheric intake valve. The exhaust valve is operated by the cam, and there is no governor. I marked the needle valve setting with a Sharpie. That's as it was received from the factory. And the speed of this engine will be determined strictly by a needle valve adjustment. These tend to only run at one speed anyway. Intake limited by the size of this carburetor. So when you restrict the air fuel that can get in here, it can only run that fast. Quite a large fuel tank goes from here to here. And this is the intake for the carburetor. Again, you'll have to make sure that you get the air out of here. You can put fuel in the tank, pull this off, tip this up a little bit, let that run out on a paper towel, put it back on the carburetor, and that should take care of that. And when you first time you spin it, you just choke that a little bit with your finger. It should take off. The water jacket for water cooling is pretty good size, a little larger than some. The cylinder is held onto this base with some studs that are threaded in here and then metric nuts. So it looks to me like the easiest way to replace the O-ring in here would be to remove these four nuts and just slide this off of the piston, replace the O-ring on the piston, and then slide this back into position. I did check the needle valve, and that is 1/8 of a turn open. Usually, this will start in that range, and as this warms up, then you can close down on that a little bit. Not much. Everything on the engine seems to be tight. Check to make sure that spark plug wire is up against the spark plug. Sometimes that gets pulled loose a little bit from the packaging. And I have three batteries in place. We'll fuel it up, give it a test. Fuel tank isn't quite as large as it appears. It doesn't quite hold one of these little bottles. This bottle was about that full, and I still have some left in there. Took the fuel line off, dripped it off onto a paper towel. I spun this with a cordless, and you can actually just put your finger on there and it'll prime itself up. Looks like I have a little bubble returning in there, but once I start running it, that'll come out of there. Put a little oil here and here and on both sides of this shaft for the gear on the cam. Oil the gears where this push rod slides through there, gets a little oil. On all these pivot points on the clevis, I put some on the springs and on the valves. Should be good to go. A bit annoying. I didn't notice the water running down here. This manufacturer makes a good product, but sometimes they're a little bit hasty in their assembly. And I know for a fact they test run the engines, but they do not test this water tank. And I know they don't want to do that because then they'd have to empty the water out and wait for this to dry before they could package it. There are two O-rings in here that seal this water tank to the cylinder liner. They have damaged one of these O-rings and the water's running out of there. So, if you are going to play with these model engines, then you might as well make up your mind you're gonna have to work on them once in a while. Sometimes it will be when you first get it. To fix this, I will have to take the head off. When I disconnect the fuel line and the spark plug wire, that head will come off, this push rod will come out. This push rod goes into a pocket in this follower is what rides on the cam. So that will come out of there. And then I will have to take these four nuts off and take this off of this base. And then I'll be able to push that liner out, determine what size the O-rings are, install new O-rings, and then put it back together. Not a big deal, but something you should be aware of and willing to do if you're going to play with some of these engines. And if you're not willing to do it, then you're not going to be able to enjoy running some of these. I'm going to go ahead and run this very briefly without any water in the tank, just to verify that it runs. And then I'm going to pull the head and the liner. I never know which way one of these is going to run. This one runs counterclockwise from this side.